Pass this over to Randy, and find my little notes here on Randy. Here we go. Randy Spranger from Harley-Davidson. How Harley-Davidson is revving up with social media. Randy's been providing internet and emerging media strategy and solutions for clients, products, and brands for more than 15 years. He's obviously an early adopter in this whole arena. As the manager of electronic advertising and digital direct promotions at Harley-Davidson, Randy is responsible for all aspects of paid search, social media, content syndication, and mobile advertising. He also oversees a team dedicated to direct mail and marketing analytics. Prior to that, he spent 8 years with global oversight of Harley's corporate websites and email programs. Before joining Harley-Davidson, he worked at a number of advertising agencies providing e-commerce websites and emerging media solutions for clients ranging from banking to retail. And this guy's pretty amazing. He was over in Brussels and he was emailing me back and forth. An incredible guy. So on that note, I'm going to pass the microphone to Randy Spranger, and I hope we're up technology-wise. Are we? Yeah? I think so.
All right. But before we jump over, let's give Anne a big hand for putting this all on and her hard work. What I wanted to play was, and I will look for it here quickly, it is a video that Harley-Davidson did a few years back, and it was a video that we had called The Creed, and it was kind of a cool video that had had a snapshot of all of our riders and a bunch of other folks in it, and here we go. Don't mind the overlay advertisement.
We believe in going our own way, no matter which way the rest of the world is going. We believe in bucking the system that's built to smash individuals like bugs on a windshield. Some of us believe in the man upstairs. All of us believe in sticking it to the man down here. We believe in the sky, and we don't believe in the sunroof. We believe in freedom. We believe in dust, tumbleweeds, buffalo, mountain ranges, and riding off into the sunset. We believe in saddlebags, and we believe that cowboys had it right. We believe in refusing to knuckle under to anyone. We believe in wearing black because it doesn't show any dirt or weakness. We believe the world is going soft, and we're not going along with it. We believe in motorcycle rallies that last a week. We believe in roadside attractions, gas station hot dogs, and finding out what's over the next hill. We believe in rumbling engines, pistons the size of garbage cans, fuel tanks designed in 1936, freight train-sized headlights, chrome and custom paint. We believe in flames and skulls. We believe life is what you make it, and we make it one hell of a ride. We believe the machine you sit on can tell the world exactly where you stand. We don't care what everyone else believes. Amen.
So any of you feel like going out and buying a motorcycle after that? Okay, good. Sarah, good. There's a dealer close by. So I show that for a couple of different reasons. I show that to show you, when we talk about Harley-Davidson and social, this is where our customers are socializing. It's actually out on the road. We have an offline, online type of issue or challenge, if you will, when it comes to the brand of Harley-Davidson. And when you think about socializing, the motorcycle and the product itself is actually kind of a rite of passage. And if you want to socialize and be social, you probably need a Harley-Davidson to do it, because you can't pull up on your Suzuki or Yamaha or some other clone bike. So with that, I'm going to kind of dive in. So what am I going to talk about today? First of all, I'll answer the obvious question. Yes, I am a rider, and I am in the market for a new Street Glide touring bike. So this was taken from the 105th anniversary in the staging area that I waited 3 hours on the hot asphalt by the Brewer Stadium to wait for the parade to kick off. But at any rate, just to talk about our approach, accomplishments, some of the blog outreach that we do, kind of how we put all this together and what the learnings are that we've had. To give just a quick snapshot of the immense team that I work with behind me, there really isn't one. We are in the world right now of kind of adopting this media like probably a lot of other brands are, through single people. I've heard some of the comments with some of the speakers about a person and a half, two and a half people. As Ann mentioned, really the area that I'm in and work for is really in the advertising, and it's broken out that way around electronic advertising. So the beauty of that is it's not just social off in a silo, but the challenge is it's not just social off in a silo. So along with that, the consumer master that was mentioned with the direct mail piece, and then we do a lot of leveraging of outside resources. In some cases, social media agency and search agency, as you may have heard in some of the SEO and how you can actually conversion analysis and how it makes sense, we're working on those same agencies doing both of those for us. So I brought this slide up just as a reminder to myself that, so how did Harley get into all of this? Holiday of 07, Harley Davidson, some of you might have seen the commercial, came up with the biker clause, bad Santa type of idea. And our agency at the time, who still is our agency of record, but our traditional agency thought, well, we'll get into this social thing and we'll do a biker clause MySpace page and won't that be cool? And I bring that up because that was kind of the entree and then the end of that type of relationship where it was just a campaign. A lot of agencies want to do social media as a point solution, just a here's a tactic, as Sue had pointed out, Sue Spate in her discussion today, which was great about kind of what level are you at. We were working with an agency that thought this is a great tactic. They didn't see the bigger solution that was out there. So we got in at another point, and where it really kind of hit us in the face was in 08 with MySpace. And we did an advertising buy, and within that, with MySpace, there was Operation MySpace, and we thought military, Harley Davidson, a third of our owners are military or vets. I'm seeing some head nods, probably Harley riders. Great. And we thought, well, let's sponsor that and get in and start building that. Well, the thing that didn't come with that automatically was, well, what are we going to do as Harley Davidson? Where are all these people, all these friends going to go to connect with the brand? We didn't have a presence out there. So I went to leadership and said, you know, we should really build this out just to have it so people have a landing place. And that kind of propelled us into it, which was more of a, well, taking a tactic and driving it up into the business and really through through a strategy. So we'll have to check this with you, Sue, whether these are actually objective strategies and tactics, but perfect. So really the objective and how we started into this was, well, let's get out into this media, and if we're going to do it, let's do it in a way that's consistent with the brand, but let's not just be out there, let's actually attract people and then let people be participants and evangelists for us through that medium. And right now, even as, you know, as we're working through kind of that next set of where are we going from here, it really is looking at it saying, are we a global brand? Or are we showing ourselves looking out as a corporate site? Are we just an advertising channel? Or are we really a lifestyle? And this is just a place where people can bump into us and get a flavor of what Harley Davidson's all about. So In the framework of that, really looking at a couple of strategies. Let's fish where the fish are, right? It tends to be overused in this medium, but it is true. Let's go out, if we're gonna attract new people, all those folks you saw in that already have a bike, as a lot of you are probably well aware, our demographic is aging with us. It's about 45, 46 years old. And how do we start getting younger folks into that? Well, this is a great place to do that. You'll see some stats on that in a minute. Also, let's establish lasting connections. So let's not just go out there and have it a one-time visit. Let's actually establish connections with these folks and have conversations and not just have a pass through and touch the brand. We don't have a brand visibility problem, you know, which is fortunate. What we have is bringing people in and actually having them engage with the brand, not just awareness of it. And then how can we get them over to our corporate sites? And also, how can we engage further and evolve that channel of HD.com so it's not just one place and one place to go? So this is, these are some old stats. Q2 of 09, we were kind of looking at some Facebook stats, and as most of you probably are aware, I don't even know the latest count. I think Facebook is now claiming probably 300 million folks. And you know what we watch is that we watch that age, because we're getting the 40-year-olds and the 50-year-olds. Where can we drive a little younger on the brand and what makes sense? So paying attention to some of that, looking at Facebook, looking at MySpace, really where they've come out of, and we found there's a reason to be in both. But when you start looking down here at these numbers, and as most of you are probably aware, MySpace came out, and one of the early stats I remember hearing was MySpace was at about 107 million users, Facebook was at about 80 million, and now MySpace actually I don't think is too far off from the 125, maybe 130, 135, and as we said, Facebook is at 300 million, so definitely something going on there. You'll see a lot of the examples and a lot of the stuff that I'm going to show is Facebook specific, and that's not by accident at all. Corporate websites are doomed. My belief is, and this is my belief, that we're seeing traffic trend down on corporate websites, because what I think a lot of people touched on through presentations today, what's happening is people are consuming the media differently. They're not going to the website to learn everything they can. They're actually pulling it in through feed readers, Twitter, whatever it may be, wherever they're going to consume their information. It could even be Facebook. There's probably a lot of folks in here that spend more time on Facebook than they actually spend on corporate websites. We still know that people are going to go to product pages, right, for Harley. It's kind of the, what does the mothership have or the corporate site that is really the place to go for that kind of information? We're actually even starting to sneak some of that out into these places as well, but that's the reason for that statement. I think they're not doomed if corporate websites start thinking about things like Facebook Connect and other places to integrate, but if they just continue to be the same old website, their traffic levels are going to drop dramatically. So how did Harley approach this? Well, from a social side and content side, how did we go about that? We really worked with taking our website, looking at the content we have, like the video you just saw, and said, well, let's put it out on YouTube. Let's also put that content out in some of the other social networking places, right? We've got this kind of the social content, which is YouTube, social networking places. Let's put some other events. So let's start populating that with some information. Bruce Springsteen at the 105th, other information that's newsworthy. And then let's actually tie that in with bloggers. And now let's also reach out to the bloggers and tie them in. Because what starts to happen is, as they write about it, you see all these arrows coming back to Harley. So at the end of the day, HD.com, we want to get people kind of in the outpost areas, and we do want to drive them to the corporate site. But they're not, the barrier of them going straight to the corporate site might be high enough that we want to give them a flavor out in other places, in other places where they travel. So, as I believe Paula mentioned this morning about, I think it was YouTube and Twitter equals gold, our belief is the social content side plus the social networks plus bloggers actually equals plutonium, because it's amazing what can happen when you get all three of those working together. And what happens, right, is you have, get the content out, you get out into the space, you get friends to start joining your network while you're seeding content of YouTube, and we just saw a perfect example of that before. You were looking at that video, which I went out and pulled off of YouTube, which is, you know, might be a place where I hang out to watch the latest sitcom or movie trailers that are coming out. That gets you more friends. You start getting out into the blogosphere, and we actually
seed out to bloggers and point them back to YouTube. So we're not just saying, hey, here's a video. We're saying, hey, we just released this brand new video over here. Go take a look at it. They drive people back into those videos. We tend to get more fans or friends or more people, more engaging relationships, hopefully. And then profiles promoting the blogs, blog traffic back. If you have the dollars to sprinkle in a little image ads and target ads, which I will tell you we've done very little of, but we have such a passionate following and passionate group that we haven't needed to do that, but that definitely does help. Quick side note on that, the Where the Wild Things Are movie that's coming out this weekend, we were talking with a group that had some, an agency that was involved in that, and I believe what they quoted was they have about 1.4 million fans in Facebook. I think they've garnered that in about 3 or 4 weeks. And when I asked, could there possibly have been a little media buy behind that? And they said, yes, absolutely. So it is something that those dollars definitely help, really to charge things up. We have not done a lot of that. This just shows you, as you guys all know, you know, if all of you in here start talking about anything, presentation your day today, you probably all have about 100 people or 100 touch points, and that just starts to emanate out. So Harley has really approached this, and we've gotten into the social structure, social media, if you will, not only for Harley Davidson itself, but what you're seeing with the number one is a dark custom. It's not a brand. It's a logo and kind of a mindset that we're working with, really focused at the young adult group. You may have seen some ads out there as well. So it's Dark Custom is what the name of that is. And then Buell, which is our sport bike line as well. So it was kind of interesting in preparing for today while I was online last night. We just rolled our 300,000 fan on Facebook, which was cool, to kind of roll through that. And we'll talk a little bit more about things that we're doing in some other cases, but this right now, you can see that picture up there, we've maintained really that thought of kind of what you saw in the beginning. It's a social place for a bunch of these people to connect, although they are all on the road. That's what we're seeing with Facebook. This is what some of our fans look like and where they're from. Indonesia, Manchester, Boulder, Colorado, South Africa, Ann Arbor, Michigan, Chicago, Illinois. One of the pages, we've really made use of the tabs. And I will tell you a short case study or comment. So before Facebook actually switched over into the new design that they're in or the new way that they're doing the tabbing, this really was our landing page. And we were really thinking, okay, let's use this. We can get our latest ads in there, whatever the advertisement might be. And we can really have people kind of engage. Really what we were doing was it was just a giant billboard to something. And then Facebook switched over and switched it that these corporate profiles were just like profiles that you and I may have, which took it over to what you saw in this last slide with the wall, and the engagement level that we had was amazing. So the switch for us was a really good thing that had happened. The other way that we've used Facebook, we've actually done some ads, and we've kind of done the old, if we're running it in USA Today or somewhere else, let's put it out here as well for people to get some visibility to it. But the cool thing with that is we've actually, what you're seeing up towards the top of that, is we've allowed people to kind of go ahead and carry that forward. They can share it, they can download it, they can print it. We've also, likewise, on the website of HD.com itself, allowed people to do the sharing, kind of that bookmarking that you had seen in some of the earlier presentations. We do have multiple segments that we target. You heard of one before, which is young adult. Women is another big area for us. We have about 10% of new bike sales every year go to women. So it's an area that we definitely believe is a growth opportunity. And in this case, this is pretty well picked up, syndicated directly from HD.com and dropped in here, even with the events really doing a syndication of that. But what we thought is, while we're out in Facebook in this place where fans, friends, whatever it may be, are hanging out, Let's also give them a place, and if they want to dive a little deeper into content, let's port it over there and let people engage with the content right there. They can always go over to hd.com as well. This is the MySpace landing page. You can see the lopsidedness of the numbers, which I would say is part MySpace fault, part our fault. I say part MySpace because they just haven't been growing a lot, but it is part our fault because when it comes to music, there's a huge opportunity for us, and what MySpace is really based in and grounded in with music is really a great opportunity for us. Here's what some of our MySpace fans look like, including Zion, folks that have friended us. YouTube channel, we just took a kind of a blaze through that. We have put some content out there I'll touch on in a little bit that has really moved some of these numbers up. But you can see video plays, subscribers, how many channel views. The beauty for us is content, I believe, is still king on the internet. And we've got a lot of stuff and a lot of passionate people and fans. So it works out great for us to really let people see that and really consume it out where they want to consume it, where they're looking at it. Twitter's a fairly new thing for us. We jumped in January. I would say it's something that we're still playing with. It's really in its infancy. The place where we really started to get some momentum on it, and you're seeing by the low numbers of followers and following, we've kind of used it as an update tool, meaning if we're at an event or something is going on, we're pointing and telling our folks in Facebook, hey, we're at the Academy of Country Music Awards or we're at the Sturgis Rally. Follow us on Twitter and come over there and follow us. So we're actually tweeting and getting people over here to kind of engage and get the blow-by-blow, if you will, throughout whatever it is we're doing and really having folks engage with Twitter. It is something we are still considering, like Scott Monty from Ford, who has kind of become self-evangelized himself and said, this is where Ford is making their play. They're really out in the Twitter space, and you can find everything out between him with a brand new car release or if he's dropping his kids off for school, which seems a little odd, but it is still the Wild West out there with how people are using it. So definitely an area we are looking at to do more with. Another area to touch on is how we've brought some of this together and how we've taken traditional PR and really thought about not only just getting the ad placement, but what else can we do with it. So in this case, really around kind of a social influencer strategy, we've worked with Ludacris and Shauna, had them customize bikes. Another segment that we look to target is the African-American segment. And folks that are within that segment, they are a lot about customizing of motorcycles. And it is really amazing the amount of money some of those folks will actually spend on customizing their Harley. So what you're seeing here is an online piece that they had also had a competition for. But the nice thing was Ludacris, actually, who has, you probably can't see it, 202,000 followers, decided to drop a tweet in on his page about Harley shoot today at the crib to promote Battle of the Sexes. They're giving me and Sean a free haul of Harley, the perks of being a rapper. So in working with him and actually touching 200,000 people that he influences, you know, that are following him, was a great thing to do, kind of an added bonus for us. It's not happening. I think the next slide, there's a picture of his bike, which is a customized Fat Boy and Softail family. Social integration is kind of the new value add. I remember the day when it was, hey, we're going to do an advertisement for you, and if you're going to do an ad placement in a magazine, Maxim, Sports Illustrated, whatever it may be, their ad folks and media folks were saying, oh, and by the way, if you want a banner ad or something on the website, you know, we'll give that to you as well. In some cases, you know, ad folks were banner, what? What are you talking about? It really feels like the social integration is kind of the next step in that, which is we're starting to push more when we're doing traditional media buys website buys, saying, well, what about social? What are you guys doing in Facebook? What are you doing in MySpace? What are you doing on YouTube? What are you doing on Twitter? Is there stuff that we can add in as value add and take advantage of as well? So the next thing, does anybody have any questions on any of that? I'm just going to touch on blog outreach quickly as well. So blog outreach. We are in the advertising side. We have a PR group that is product PR as well, who sits within the advertising side of the house, which is just the way it is structured at Harley today. And the PR folks have been dabbling in this a little bit, but because it was part of that kind of the magic triangle, we call it, with social content, social networking, and blog outreach
being together, we kind of propelled ourselves into it. What we had to do was we worked really closely with our PR group. The last thing we want to do is actually scoop our PR group. They don't seem to take that real well. When we did that once, and that was the last time we did that, which was just because of moving quickly, and it was about a 24-hour period where with a product release, we tend to get close to bloggers. So we're just joining the conversation. Our approach to blogging is we're not pushing it down anybody's throat. You heard from Esther just prior to this with Kmart. You know, it's not Harley going out saying, hey, you have to do this. It's Harley going out saying, hey, we've noticed you blog about motorcycles. We basically combed the blogosphere and said, who are the influential bloggers out there? And just said, we want to introduce ourselves, and when we have product and we have information from time to time, we're going to tell you about it. Whatever you want to do with it is up to you. Which has been a great relationship. And at first the PR folks said, well, do you have any idea how many questions you're going to get about back at you? Those bloggers are going to want to know, can I get a product? Can I do this? Can I do that? We actually haven't had a lot of that. Because for us, it's just, again, content is king. The blogger's saying, hey, thanks, Harley. You're telling me a little something that's coming out. And you'll see another example of where we've taken that actually to another step. But so looking at the and identifying the relevant blogger community, and then just having relationships with them. And as a lot of, I'm sure, PR experts like yourselves have found, a lot of the traditional PR, when we were talking with PR, they said, you know what, some of these sites are on our list, because it isn't just about the traditional media. It actually is, there's websites that they see as credible media, and we're definitely working with them together. These are some of the correspondence just from, thanks for sending this note, you know, I'll keep an eye on it, I'll post it to my site, you know, just a bit of a dialogue with them. In some cases, good to hear from you, thanks for staying in touch. I have to confess I've never ridden, but I hope to. So us just staying in touch with bloggers has been a pretty good approach. One of the other areas that I had mentioned, the targets that I mentioned previously, was with women. So this was something where we went out, took a look at who writes, who has women blogs about motorcycling, and what can we, just as we give them content, what comes up, Biker Chicks blog and another blog, and we definitely see traction in those just by kind of seeding content out to them. This was another blog, which is where things really start to come together. We were in New York, I think, this past weekend. This was posted on the 13th. And we were doing an event there, in a PR event, and we had some bikes there, and some of the press, I think they were doing desk side visits, and some of the press was riding bikes and invited. And along with that, some of the bloggers that we have in the New York area, we invited to jump in and hop on the bikes. Because we knew which ones were riders. And you can see here, what would you say if Harley invited you to a swanky New York party and asked you to demo ride a motorcycle, or ride their motorcycle around the city for the day? Hell yeah. And so that kind of explains what happened to Diana and myself in this past weekend. So it was something that we invited them and said, as bloggers, you're credible media, and you know what, we want to do you a favor, surprise you, invite you to ride some bikes. Well, what we ended up doing with their post is we also, and this just went, this was yesterday, because you can see down in the bottom left we were still under the 300 mark. we took that and we posted it in here, and we had gotten 623 people that liked that. This was in 6 hours, and 158 comments along with that. So really an area that for us, as we're creating some of that content and those relationships, we're bringing those back in to another channel and into things like Facebook and seeing comments, you know, no, but my brother has one. I'm getting a rocker C within 2 years. You can kind of see the gamut we kind of run within Facebook. We've got people that are dreaming about it, and we've got people that are really engaged in it. Facebook wall, just with some posts, just some other questions. Wants to hear about the first, your first riding memory. We got 699 people to comment on that. Harley wants to know, what's your favorite 2010 model? I'll show you a little more detail on that in a second. Wants to know, who has influenced you to take up riding? So when we talk about voice of the customer, or kind of that crowdsourcing, or just having a, you know, having a focus group, it was interesting. Our market planning group came out a couple months ago, or maybe longer, and said, hey, we've got this online, we've moved from paper to an online group. We now have an online focus group. And I kind of had to scratch my head and said, well, we kind of have one too, and it's a couple hundred thousand people that we get some pretty quick results from. So the market planning group has some people that, you know, they know a lot about, and then we kind of have a vast number of friends that we can use as a focus group as well. So this was the example with we took a question and said, well, let's do a poll, and while we're doing the 2010, which just in July we released the 2010 models, let's send those out and let's just see what our Facebook fans and MySpace fans have to say about this. So you can see here with the wants to know which is your favorite, how many views and comments, how many comments we had, and then also through updates what we ended up getting with MySpace. And the way that broke out, some information for us, right? Fat Boy Low, Street Glide, Wide Glide, etc. And it just gave us a snapshot of, when it comes to relationships and friends and fans that we have, what kind of bikes are they interested in? Are they actually, how do they marry with our sales data? Is it different? Is it the same with the actual data we're seeing? Just to understand, how does this group, and we're still learning every day on it, how does this group actually differ from folks that are buying? And are these mostly buyers that are friends and fans of ours? Or is there something different there? And we realize there's something different there when it comes to age and some other things that, you know, being out in the social space is a good place for us to kind of fish where the fish are right now, and work on getting that demographic lower as well. Photos, you know, another, I'm sure all of you use it, and I even believe I've heard folks quote, I don't know if it was Facebook or who it is, but that they're the largest photo gallery now in the world because of all the photos that everybody uploads. So we have great content. We go to events. People ride. What do they want to do after they ride? They want to take pictures. They want to post pictures. They want to socialize pictures. Facebook allows them to do that. And you can see beautiful pictures. Maybe next year I'll be there. Again, hitting on the dreamer side of this and the folks that are dreaming about owning a Harley someday and continuing to fuel that fire for them. Another area and another example. This was YouTube, and we had the fortune of, good fortune of having a budget where we could do a YouTube homepage takeover for a day. So for those of you that don't know, YouTube actually sells that spot for a 24-hour period. They have now also looked at expanding that. You can actually buy a larger masthead that you probably have seen day to day. The actual masthead across the top, that's even more engaging than this. But we had a lot of success with this, and this was our Marissa Miller campaign that we had with the V-Rod Muscle, so one of our new motorcycles that came out last year, and using Marissa Miller in a photo shoot. And while we were doing that photo shoot for one of our ads, we also videotaped it and had video of it. So this was the actual video, and you can see how well that performed. Again, the right content in the right place tends to perform really well. So even YouTube was a little surprised at some of the stats that we had. But a really good tool to, you know, again, this was a little brand visibility and engagement, right, to get folks in and get them looking at product. How are we doing on time, Ann?
Another minute. Actually, you have about five.
All right, perfect. other things we've done, social media campaigns that we've utilized. So some of those ads, we didn't just throw the ad out there. This is a place where I mentioned we've got people coming to hd.com for product. We thought, why not take a microsite and actually bring the product out there? So this ride free campaign was buy a Sportster now, you're guaranteed the MSRP a year when you turn it in, if you turn it in for a big twin. So it was really about the Sportster series, and we gave people information about that, as well as Super Ride, which was about demoing bikes. And here again, you're seeing that microsite of where we're sharing details. Still a believer, at least the direction we're headed in is, you know, people, while they're in here, if they're going to take a second to hop over to a brand and investigate while they're on Facebook, let's not make them jump again out to the corporate site. Let's try and give them as much information as we can, and if they want to make the leap, let's let them make that. Another example of something that we've been playing with, which is really just a share mechanism, but what you're seeing is in new models, we said, hey, tweet this. And when you click on that, it actually brings you into Twitter. It asks you to log in, and it automatically has the check out the 2010 new models, et cetera, et cetera. It already has it placed in there for you, and all you have to do is post it. So it was just this really simple idea of let's just help this viral nature and help people post, because if you were to, for some of the Harley riders, say, hey, do you want to share this content? They may look at it and say, well, what happens when I'm clicking on these buttons? What? Wait a second, what's going on? So we thought, well, let's give this a shot. We've had about 7,000 or 8,000 folks that have actually clicked on that and brought that into their Twitter feed. A couple other quick examples from kind of a tactical marketing. New York Times ad, I don't know, some of you have probably heard or read, the New York Times did a piece on us that had said, you know, Harley's getting older, they're not looking at younger folks, et cetera, et cetera. So the good news is we have a CMO that came from GM who is pretty aggressive, pretty young, and the whole campaign you're seeing with Screw It, Let's Ride, the ride free, you're starting to see a bit of a theme here, said, well, let's place this ad, let's buy in the New York Times and buy a double truck ad, and let's put this in, that you can file your obituary where the sun don't shine, and then with the rest of the copy, and really letting people just speak their voice. It was, you know, you want to share it, do you want to print it, do you want to download it? We ended up really bringing this into the social side versus hd.com. So it wasn't, hey, if you want to see the ad or you want to talk about it, go to hd.com. It was something that we utilized in the social space, which worked out really well. Here you're seeing the share side of it, when that actually gets shared from somebody. New York Times response, so of course it also created chatter with comments, 169 comments. Loved it, thought it would be much better than the author's original. Right, fantastic. And then the last thing I'll share with you is another piece that we did, which was a mosaic piece, and it was really a call for, if any of you have seen the latest new model literature, the cover of the Harley-Davidson new model bike book is actually a logo that looks like that, made up of a mosaic of all kinds of photos. And those are all customer-submitted photos. So we took advantage of all of the media properties, right, from kind of a, let's get in and use all, let's actually use what we've got and do a call for photos and really try and socialize this and just let the people that are networked with us and that are interested, let's let them supply the photos. So that was posted within Harley-Davidson. You're seeing in the middle here, Harley Davidson is extending the time, so we even extended the time for photos and just communicated it to our friends. Here was one of the small display ads we did. We did it in MySpace along with a bulletin, so what you can't read and see is really a bulletin within somebody's profile. We tweeted about it. We used Dig and StumbleUpon, which was mentioned earlier. Blog outreach, we used our blogger network to have them talk about it. The sharing piece of it, you know, if you came to the site, which was actually done by the same folks that with Pedigree, which I think Sue showed earlier, with the Pedigree website, they actually had done a mosaic like this, and it was the same group that had put that together and kind of had the technology in a box to allow you to submit a photo and then share that. The other beauty of this is it wasn't just submit, it was if your picture got picked, you could come back and find out exactly where you were on the cover of the Harley Davidson book. So it was kind of a neat, use social to submit, have people do submissions. You'll see some numbers here in a second of what we had. So 12,551 visits, 4,400 photos collected. This was in about a 2-3 week period. One of the beauties of the Harley Davidson brand is if you ask people to participate, look out because they will. They will quickly, and a lot of them will, which is truly amazing. Referring domains, so where did a lot of those people come from? Well, HD.com, I think, had it on the homepage for a while. We got 37-38%. Facebook, 27% of those photos that we got actually came from Facebook folks. So again, that shows you, and the staggering drop-off here with MySpace, but again, it shows you that power of that relationship. When we're asking and we're reaching out to folks, this is another channel and another place where we're reaching out to folks we have a relationship with. Dig, stumble upon, blog outreach, etc. So some quick learnings and then questions, if you have any. Just in the year and a half or so that we've been in this, have a reason why to get in the game. So have an objective and a strategy, and if you don't have one, find somebody that will help you get there. You don't have to know it all. There are groups out there, and we've heard some of them, I think, throughout the day today, that actually have a pretty good grasp on this, and they can actually help you out with it. Understand your environment. So who's doing it already? You know, the IS guy sitting downstairs in their cubes already doing all of this stuff? Do they already have a presence out there for you? Know how it all ties together. We talked about that a little bit with the magic triangle piece. Work with the right partner. I mentioned the agency, our traditional agency, that got into this a little bit, and then also our digital and kind of interactive side of the house, which really grabbed hold of this and took us to where we are today. Having the right partner is really important. Also, start listening, right? People are already out there talking about your brand. We heard today a little bit about the listening side of it. We're looking to do more of that, actually. There's some tools mentioned that the social discussion and what is being said out there is definitely something that we are starting to look more into and pay attention to. We're hearing it now in Facebook and MySpace, but we want to take it to the next level and actually be, you know, looking out and spidering and crawling everything that's going on to really make sure we're listening to it all. The sales job, make sure you have a story to tell when you approach the organization. I presented it to the CMO. Again, he's the guy that gave cars away on Oprah, so he was pretty open to where things were. He understood digital, so it wasn't a hard sell, but it's kind of, well, what are you going to do? So you want to get out here, you know, what are you going to do and give me an example? Because a lot of folks at a leadership level may not be tied into it. Fortunately, some of them are at Harley. Have measurements, so key performance indicators, and something that leadership's looking for. Try something. I think there's some areas that I know we have and others have done. Really, it's that constant, well, someday, someday, someday. And with this media, you have to get into it, but when you get into it, start small, and you need to be prepared. As we heard from the Southwest with Paula this morning, I think it's, if you're gonna embark on some of this, and it's blogging or it's something else, with PR, as many of you are aware, you really need to be ready for what's going to happen once you're putting yourself out there. We're working closely with customer service, PR, a number of other areas that I mentioned, really to make sure that we're coming at this the right way. Some people look at it from the outside and go, geez, it's Harley Davidson's brand. Why aren't you guys doing more? Well, there's a lot we're doing. There's a lot more to do, but we're being fairly cautious about how we're getting into it. But again, try something. And that is it. Thank you. If anybody knows what our competitors are doing, let me know. I'm all ears. I mean, we know what they're doing, but I don't know what their return on investment is. Our return on investment, so to back up on that, our investment has typically come through a lot of the campaign funding and also a baseline. So the amount to get in the game and to be out there, we are not yet attaching bike sales directly to these relationships, right? I mean, that is the place we're going and we want to go. What we're doing right now is looking at it, and the return on investment is, I would say, those relationships that we're setting up, right? So it's the reach that we're getting. It hasn't gotten all the way down to motorcycle sales, although I would tell you we're tracking the segments, and we're also looking at how much did those segments bounce or move over last year when it comes to sales. So, okay?